Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So many of us have met at the NSF EarthCube meeting a few months ago, I think. Who was there in this audience? So I really had a good time in that meeting. One of the main focus for each group that built at NSF EarthCube is to discuss user scenarios and use scenarios for each concept that I come up with. And I was heavily involved in particular with this data interoperability or interop concept work group. And another group I was involved is the education and the workforce and development group. Let me see if that one is here as well. Yeah. So we had great discussions in this context, and we decided that why don't we continue the discussions at the eScience in October. So there we put together the panel. So that's why we're here today. I'm going to start by giving you some ideas why I'm involved on behalf of Microsoft Research and how we hope that the program that we built called Open Data for Open Science and Microsoft Research could help with data interoperability. And then we will go through and by each panel list, we will introduce some concepts that we're trying to build through this effort. And then ultimately, the goal for the panel is to get discussions going with the audience, and we wanted to get some ideas from other people and then input into this interoperability effort at EarthCube as well. So at Microsoft Research, I work at the eScience, and in particular, Earth, Energy, and Environment. And we started to engage with environmental researchers about 2 years ago. And there's a lot of learnings that you will recognize and agree with me, because this is all the, you know, what I have learned from the workshops and the conversations with many of you. And the grand challenge, I'm sure we all agree, is that there's vast amount of heterogeneous data. Back then when we started, we didn't call it big data. Nowadays, this is all big data. Not only big in volume, but also big in the trouble of sharing the data that come in different formats and units or scales. And then we keep on talking about how it is lack of easy to use tools and then incentive for people to share data and lack of tools for easy adoption of standards. I'm sure that you would all agree with me that there are already quite some standards out there. So the problem is not to create more standards. The problem is how we can enable the adoption of standards. And personally, I find that there's some unique challenge in this area is that, you know, I have a physics background. So I remember when I was a PhD student, I dreamed that someday I'd become a Nobel Prize winner, right? So that seems to be the ultimate goal to be a scientist. But as I was working, you know, I've been working with environmental scientists, and I realized that we have a bigger mission. So it doesn't end with the paper publishing. We want to use the results to influence, the decision makers and the general public. And we want to also enable everybody to do science with us so we can scale the effort. So ultimately, we really wanted to use what we do to do this, to make social impact. And then my practice in this area would be, work on this program called Open Data for Open Science. And it is a program that is inspired by the fourth paradigm science. I'm sure that everybody's familiar by now that the concept of how nowadays dealing with data, that data-intensive research is different from the classic mode of having the hypothesis, working on experiments, and improve the theory. Rather, you do pattern discovery and scientific discovery just directly into the huge amount of data. And then technically, how we do that is by using a data protocol that is widely used nowadays at Microsoft called Open Data Protocol, in short, OData. And what old data can do is really to unlock data from silos of applications. So I'll give you some examples. And throughout these events, and if you're interested in, you know, learning about old data or you know, discuss what old data may do for you, and then I would love to have some, you know, offline conversations with you. So how exactly do we implement open data for open science? Our expertise is in computing, so we collaborate with environmental researchers to explore new ways of using our software. And that's really about engagement, engaging the cutting-edge technologies with your scenarios, with your data, and perhaps even with something you feel like could be, you know, lead to discovery, but no idea where to start. And then, in practice, we really try to take advantage of the old data compliant technologies at Microsoft. That includes the, you know, Azure Data Market, Azure SQL Server, and a lot of large-scale software, including SharePoint and all that. So we're also trying to, you know, make all the tools and technologies that we're developing, such as you know, Fetch Climate that Drew showed, to be old data compliant. So in that way, we can have interoperability between not only data, but also applications. So, and I like what, recently when we did Open Data for Open Science workshop in Australia, one of the architects who did old data presentation for us says, old data is really about open up your data, not your database. I think that says a lot. So you really want to share your data and separate the service model from your data model, and then people don't really want to query your database directly. So here's an example of how exactly we apply that. At Microsoft Research, we have a data center. We support the data center not only from technical cyber infrastructure perspective, but also from the environmental perspective. With running a big data warehouse requires a lot of monitoring. We have developed a lot of sensor technologies just to make sure that the data warehouse goes well from controlling the temperature, the humidity, and all that environment in that area. So these sensors being used in data warehouse, we're trying to leverage that and make an environmental observatory platform. So let me show you what the final form factor is about this project Clio, that is the sensor that we're creating. So putting together a lot of unique technologies from Microsoft Research, and we're creating a sensor of this size, ultra mobile, and the battery in this one can run for up to 2 years. And this is one of the two final form factors. And this one allows extensible hardware design as well. So this, by designing out of the box, this size can measure temperature and it has accurate GPS and the humidity, all that. But you can extend more hardware chips so that you can measure CO2, H2S, any other chemicals that is environmentally related. Another form factor that's coming soon, so we intend to demonstrate it at AGU, is half of this size. And that would be really specially designed for enabling citizen science. So the idea is that if we donate a set of devices like this at Yellowstone Park, and then when you check in at the park, you get your map, and then maybe you can pick up one of the devices like this and just hook it up on your, so like a keychain. So you put it on your backpack and you do hiking, all that. At the end, when you check out of the park, you hand back this device. And the device actually just can connect through a audio jack to any phone or any laptop to transfer the data to the cloud back in on the Azure data market. So that way then other people who's not collecting data, whether or not, you can have an aggregated view of all the data being collected by tourists or by the cycling courier deliverer people, or workers in the forest who may carry devices like this. And then given the battery time, this can also be tied up on the animals, so then we can do that kind of animal tracking kind of measurements as well. Another use of this is that It can be used to gather the ground-based data to calibrate the satellite and data information. So that's what's so unique about this. We plan to roll it out and then making the client software a open source, and then the hardware design, the design also as an open source, so that people can take it and extend it, and then plug it into any mobile device that they may come up with application with. So this is one of the examples of how we use old data and connect different devices and scenarios together. So just to give you an idea what I mean by that, I hope it works. So we have some deployed old data feeds on one of our servers. And Drew has mentioned a lot about the World Wide Telescope. Here's the World Wide Telescope. Let me close this and show you. So we have, in World Wide Telescope, we have direct support for old data. So I can just, if I made my data service in old data format, I can just copy the URL and then say add old data feed into the visualization on. I wanted to make this scale really big so that I can make sure that I can see the data and see if I can see it and zoom in. This is what you're seeing right now is the I have some data points in the US and in the Brazil. So I can find it. So I can, having trouble to find it right now. But I should, okay, let me move on, sorry. Offline I can show you that, just give you an idea. And then recently, just like 2 days ago, I received a video that somebody sent me from China when they had a national technology for K-12 education, where a middle school put together this video. And it really shows how different technology can be put together to enable not only, do better science, but also better education. In World Wide Telescope, if you notice, it really aggregates seamlessly data from different sources. So if you go to the sky mode, we have all these sky surveys, huge amount of data from different telescopes. And then we also have the solar system, which is really the modeling and all that, that enables you to go beyond our time and beyond our galaxy. And then there is also this Earth mode that allows you to do a lot of things. And in terms of, this is my data set. I made it too big. This is my sensor data set. This one. This is one of them. New dynamic layer. So I made the scale way too big. Yeah, okay. You can see the size. So that was my old data feed from my sensor. That I intended to show you. So anyway, I was using the World Telescope to show you that ultimately, in my dream, I think that we can do this kind of data interoperability into one nice platform like World Wide Telescope. So then the users can really create stories like this, together with other technologies like natural user interface, and then kids can use it this way. Let me just go open my file directly. So that's World Wide Telescope, and they're in different modes. in joining data from different sources. They have no idea. These kids, they don't have no idea how much scientists have done with all these data and then put it into this one visualization platform. They're really enjoying it in their classroom. So then this is connect with Connect for Windows. So therefore, she can drive the screen using her body gestures. That's the Connect for Windows, the device down there. And then the touchpad with all that. It just, you see how heavy they are and what technology is doing for them. So there's a lot of things going on technology-wise and science-wise behind that flat screen that she's enjoying it. And that's what I see that the seamless interoperability can do for science and education. So I'll stop here, and I think Ilya can take it over and then give more examples of what we're trying to do with different domains, data, and then applications. Do you want to switch to your?
Yeah, let's switch to this.
Okay, so thank you very much, and any questions? So I did an introduction that how the picture should be, and in the following we're gonna discuss what tools we wish to have and how the interoperability can be enabled. Some of us will be talking about the protocol level. So this will be, if we're going to draw down at different levels. I didn't want to use all the examples of following panelists, so that was a start.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Oh, that's good. That was a great question.
Thank you, Jan, for introduction and for having us here. I believe at some point we'll need to get on these high chairs and you'll be asking questions. So feel free to ask questions during the presentations. We'll try to quickly run through some of the results and ongoing work in the projects that Jan mentioned. This is cross-domain interoperability project as part of EarthCube. So a few words about EarthCube. It is a new initiative by NSF, and I borrowed some slides from NSF with an outline of what this initiative is trying to accomplish. Essentially, the issue is there have been a lot of development of infrastructure in various fields, and some projects have been very successful, other projects have failed. It's important to understand what is the pattern of success and pattern of failure and pick up on best practices and see how what has been developed can be used to integrate data across domains because, of course, physical processes don't know domain boundaries and jurisdictional boundaries. And if you want to run models, you want to be able to quickly and seamlessly bring data from other domains. That is not always possible. Everybody talk about interoperability. Everybody have slightly different idea of what that is, depending on your specific applications. And another issue is that there are lots and lots of geoscientists funded by NSF or associated with NSF-funded programs, and a lot of data, or most of the data that are generated by these people do not end up being available for other projects. There is no common mechanism for publishing data, for figuring out what is available, accessing the data, downloading, and so on. So that's what this initiative was trying to improve on. And At the beginning, of course, there was a survey that asked whether you use data from other domains. Yes, indeed, 52% said yes. There are lots of sources that researchers try to get data from. The usual issue is that this data have been collected for some other purpose than what you have in mind. And information about intent, information about... Before I go there, one last slide about EarthCube. So NSF set it up as a collection of groups that have been tasked with development of roadmap for how cross-domain cyber infrastructure can develop. There are several so-called concept groups there at the bottom here. There are several community groups. Each of them produced a roadmap that's an outline of what needs to be done in developing infrastructure. And community events that Jan mentioned, where we all got together in June, was a big gathering of these groups where these roadmaps were presented. What will happen next? Hopefully NSF has a plan. They're trying to figure it out. The idea is that there will be a continued set of activities that and test beds that will explore how different types of data can interoperate in solving specific science problems. The issue is, as I said, what it means to go cross-domain. We have data sets collected in different under different circumstances by different researchers. There are different metadata used, and we need to reuse this data, essentially use it out of context. That has some consequences. These consequences are not quite clearly understood. What would it mean to find data that is fit for my specific use? You cannot really go and annotate data for all potential uses, right? And then discover what is the most appropriate. Another aspect of it is that, as I mentioned, there are lots of projects that developed software already and developed information systems. We want to see if these projects are actually ready to be integrated at some level. What does it mean? When we try to access data from another domain, we want to be able to discover this data, to interpret what we discovered, to access the data and retrieve the data, and to be able to integrate this with data that we have. That implies that we have at least catalogs, vocabularies, services, or some other download, some other access tools to grab the data. And the information models are made explicit so that we can connect what we have in one domain from to information models in another. We can talk about readiness of products, whether the particular product is ready for use. We can talk about readiness of process, and this is perhaps more interesting for EarthCube because it's meant to be a long-term initiative, at least for 10, 15 years. And this means that the products that we're focusing on now are not really that critical. We're trying to develop processes that would lead to software and data products that will be easy to integrate with others. The products will always be evolving. So as I said, if we look at this at four levels of interoperability, we can talk about a discovery level, where we want to discover what resources are available in another domain. Interpretation level, we need to have catalogs at this level. Then we access the services and integrate them. So when people talk about interoperability, they can talk about some of these levels or some groups of these levels. It was convenient for us to separate this into these four groups because then we can come up with a picture of cross-domain integration as where each of the silos, and these silos have been developed for several disciplines, each silos is exposed to the world as having some catalogs, vocabulary, services, and information models, ideally in some formals, accessible in a formal and standard manner, so that you can discover them and access from another domain. And then there is an upper layer, a layer of cross-domain integration, where if we have these catalogs exposed in the standard manner, then we can connect them in catalog federations. If we have vocabularies exposed as SCOS or OWL, then we can do vocabulary crosswalks. If we have services exposed in standard formats, then we can easily write clients that would go and assemble data from different services and so on. So that's the model that we tried to use as one of our starting points, and we use that to do assessment of where things are with respect to readiness for integration. So as part of it, we actually assembled a bunch of, we looked at what is available, and for each of the domains, try to find what information models exist, what catalogs exist, what vocabularies exist, and so on, and created a set of catalogs and also catalogs for models and architecture designs. So these are some of the criteria we used. Now, this project has been run only since mid-March, or I would say end of March. So what I'm telling you about here is just some preliminary results and an attempt to show you how the process may work. So that the set of criteria presented here is not final and open to discussion. These criteria have been, we try to use them to see where different infrastructures are with respect to our goal of interoperation. So for example, for catalogs, we can look at whether there is any listing of data in a particular domain that we can use to see what's available. Whether this list of data is follows some standard, some simple metadata standard, or follows more extensive metadata standard, and so on. And created matrices like that where we do the assessment. None of the systems in use came out as perfect, but they are all deficient in different ways. We can try to look at this from the perspective of, you know, gap analysis and see where effort would need to be focused to make the system more interoperable with each other. I'm not going to go through all of the details of this table. So that sort of creates a landscape of different domains talking to each other. Now we need to find where actually the low-hanging fruit is, or where we need to put effort, where it is most important to have robust interfaces between domains. And that has been a fairly difficult question to answer, because one way to look at that is to ask people, do surveys and ask, do you use data from other domains, and which domains do you use more often, how often do you try to get data from them, and so on. These questions have been asked, the surveys have been all over the place, very difficult to analyze, typically open-ended type questions. What we try to look at is catalogs of models, because models are kind of representations of use cases, right, which are already materialized in software. And for different models, we could try to see what are the data flows in the desk models. If we find consistently used pairs of domains that exchange data, then that may be a candidate for more robust interfaces to develop within them. So all model catalogs are represented with these nice tools. We can look at different types of representations and actually extract from model descriptions what which domains they get data from. And that feeds into this type of, oh, it's huge here. Need to make this smaller. Yeah, this type that shows how many models, for example, in hydrology, how many models use data from hydrology or use data from other disciplines. And that can give you an idea of what is the width of the pipe that needs to go, needs to connect different domains. Now, this is just one example of how you can use cross-domain metrics to inform priorities. That there are certainly other types of data that we can try to plug in here, but we're trying to develop a process by which community can express what is needed and where development needs to be focused. Okay. Yeah, so now returning to this diagram, these are all different projects, right? When we talk about the main stovepipes. These are data centers or otherwise managed projects that have their own governance. This part is not really managed in any way. Right? There's no governance for cross-domain interoperability. We don't even know what is the life cycle of all of these. Typically, these are transient type of crosswalks or federations that create for specific purposes. Should they have a more formally defined life cycle and management? That's an open question. So one of the outcomes of the group was to try to develop a concept for a governing body that would manage this upper layer. We call it Geoscience Interoperability Institute, and this is a list of functions that we can actually revisit later. The idea that it will combine science governance and technical governance, and on the technical side, it will be management of the four components that I mentioned that manage interoperability at four different levels: catalogs, vocabulary services, and information models. And on the science side, management of use cases and development priorities given the resources we have here. I'll finish with some examples of why it is so interesting and not quite explored topic of how you move data between domains. That's an example from using weather radar data for hydrologic forecasting. And some of the issues with weather radars that are obvious to specialists in weather radars may not be that obvious to hydrologists who actually try to apply them for to do models. When you use traditional precipitation measures, which lots of models have been originally based on, you would have different error distributions, and you would have to make corrections for other things than here, because here a big effect would be from hail contamination, for example, which is not quite well understood on the hydrology side. And this is just a list of a bunch of issues that you may face when you try to use this data for a different domain. Some other challenges that we've been looking at. We have multiple domains, and each domain has its own standards and protocols that you can use to access data catalogs and so on, which may be, of course, different from what is accepted in another domain. One option is to allow different standards and different protocols to coexist and have a brokering solution that would be managed by a third-party broker provider. Whether that's a sustainable model compared to encouraging all domains to follow common standards or at least develop profiles of common information models, and what would give you better results in the short term or in the long run, that's an open issue. And there are some other open issues that we really want your feedback on, because some of these things have been outlined in what we produced in the roadmap, but we certainly don't have a definite answer. Yes, how we support both loose coupling and tight integration for high-performance computing, because the model I showed you on the diagram is mostly a loose coupling type service-based model, but we do need to run high-performance computations as well, where all data need to be close together. One of the critical things is how do we assess fitness for use? If we have data that has been used in one context, how do we accumulate usage patterns and usage information about experience of using this data in other contexts, and whether it would be extendable enough to your specific situation? That is an open thing. Now, we will get back to these questions when we get on the high chairs. But for now, I'll just give the podium to Robert, another member of our group.
Yeah. Thanks, Ilya.
Okay.
So the five of us are going to drill
Thank you.
Down into domain interoperability from different perspective. And we would really appreciate the audience could prepare some questions, and at the end we'll have like plenty of time to discuss and get feedback from you.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you, Microsoft, for inviting me. It's nice to see friends here. Thank you, Ilya, for heading up the NSF Interoperability Project, which I am part. What I'm going to do is talk about a UK project that fits very closely with this and give some of the, which is coming to an end, and we're about to have an extension, and I'd like, as part of the discussion, to think about what the extension should look like. To give some of the lessons learned, because as Drew said before the break, many of the questions are not technical ones. Many of the things that are difficult are social questions in many ways, and how we manage the whole thing. So this is this project, which came from one of the UK research councils, which is like NSF, and it's a pilot for an environmental virtual observatory. And in itself, there are a lot of interoperability challenges. We have a whole set of people here, including me, we have computer scientists, physicists, mathematicians, biologists, chemists, social scientists in many different institutions. And even getting us all to work together is a challenge out of this. So even internally, this is a problem. Now, there's been a lot of work in the UK on interoperability in related areas. Some of you will know, think projects like MyOcean, where people are sharing ocean data, similar things, atmospheric science and so on, for sharing data. This is particularly aimed in hydrology and soil science and water quality, and it has real practical applications in this area. And many of the challenges go across multiple sorts of data, multiple models, and many sorts of tools across disciplines, organizations, and topics. We already have in the UK many different data centers which sort of work together, from these to the Met Office, the British Atmospheric Data Center, the terrestrial and freshwater data centers, and so on. We have a remit to work together, and there are lots of initiatives to get people to work together, which people are struggling to comply with, but actually, people often don't just want data. And it isn't just for scientists, this is for others. So government agencies want to know which models work. How can they do the same thing more cheaply that they're doing at the moment? And which policies that they've got work and which ones don't work? The regulators want to know how can they monitor, they can do the same amount of monitoring for less cost. Cost is a big driver of interoperability for this. How do you, and also credible apportioning of pollutant load between industry, water, agriculture, and others. These have big economic consequences. The public's really interested in this, these questions. I'm in a school of mathematical and physical sciences where we do a lot of climate research. We get lots of questions from the public about this because they're interested in it. And these sort of questions are often not very well posed. They're things like, will London run out of water, or can my children swim in the local stream, or my dog swim in the local stream, and what are the options for protecting against flooding when a supermarket wants to build a big car park in the area. Water industry, the UK water industry is privatised, unlike much of it in this country, so they want to know how can they take what they're doing and sell it overseas. What's the impact, whole impact of future flooding? How can they make sure they have enough water to supply? And as they spend about two-thirds of their total budget on electricity, how can they reduce their carbon impact and reduce the amount, use the information to reduce the amount of electricity they have to use in processing water and delivering water? And the scientists, we have lots of different questions about which models work, from the different sort of models, how do we manage uncertainty, what sort of languages and tools do we use to get models to talk to each other out of this. So we have to go beyond data in what we're doing. So typical questions, we went and asked people what they wanted at the beginning of this project. We produced sort of 42 typical questions. 42 is, if you're a restaurant at the end of the universe fan, it's important. But 42 questions, and these are four of them. From business, does the river flow height mean that my business will be flooded again, and should I insure it? That came from actually a company in the food industry. Real-time data sensors for the public want to know, is it safe for my children to swim in that stream or on that beach in real time? Have modeling tools for a policymaker. Is this land management option I'm going to agree for building development future-proof for climate change? Or decision support tools from the food industry again. What's my options for reducing my greenhouse gas emissions and amount of energy use while maintaining productivity? So this pilot, and I'm talking at quite high level because Ilya's already introduced the general topic of data of interoperability, is trying to test approaches to help people access what resources they need, whether they're a scientist, a policymaker, an industrial body, a regulator, or the public. And because so much of the data that we use as scientists is collected by non-scientists, we just had to be able to engage these other areas. And also because of the Freedom of Information Act in the UK and various other things, the public is very interested in this area, and you have always, as a scientist, to be responsive in this way legally. And so you need to have resources go beyond data. Most people don't understand about data themselves and the limitations of them. It includes models and tools like visualization, decision support systems, valuation. So this is a two-year project which is just coming to an end at the end of this year. And so we've got this whole group of different institutions, 12 end users who are very engaged with us, from water companies, from policy, from software, and land managers, and so on. And we've going at least on a monthly basis, going and testing what we're doing with groups of users. So we're not getting off track from that, because that's really important to make sure that what we're doing is useful. And so the only way of testing what we could do is try it out with real exemplars. So I'm sorry we're very specific on some of these things, and they may be rather limited at the beginning, but we're trying to have solutions which are scalable but small enough to be able to do in 2 years. So we've got exemplars at three scales, local, national, and global. I'm only going to talk about the local one in time. They're addressing different issues for different audiences, from the public, from scientists, and so on, dealing with real data models and visualizations, and looking at the potential much more broadly using a series of storyboards so we can engage people with what we're doing. So people, beyond what we can actually have time to program, that they actually, people can see the potential of the area we're doing. So it's an open architecture which at the moment we're developing on with using Amazon tools, but it doesn't particularly matter for this because everything is going to get dumped at the end of December and we'll start again with what we're doing. And a population is sufficient to demonstrate its facets, looking at the issues, the opportunities, and also trying to get a more interested community. We've looked deliberately within the UK again, not more generally, just because we knew there's EVO going on, CSIRO are doing similar activities, various other people, India and Japan, are both have similar activities to this. So you want to be able to work together, but not trying to duplicate everything. So we had a set of 7 storyboards, engaging farmers, power companies, government departments, scientists, on issues of flooding and drought and water quality, and uncertainty of looking at of in global modelling and soil carbon loss, basically, and a whole set of different models. Don't try to read all the details. Then trying to look at what we can add in value of using this sort of approach. And then there are a whole set of technical issues that we needed to be able to examine with this set of pilots, with the set of pilots across the top, and then a whole set of different issues of elasticity, of different architecture, of different openness, and so on, and how to support mashups, a whole set of different things. And these demonstrators all deal with those in different weightings. Looking at just one of these, because that's all I've got time for on this, is looking at the local flooding example, working with farmers. And we looked at three catchments. You have descriptions of the catchments here. This is one in northwest England, which is useful to use because there was a very big flood on it a few years ago, which had big economic consequences. So the local population is very sensitive, and the local authorities and so on are very sensitive in this area to flooding problems. And in real time, there's runoff data from intelligent field sensors on this, which we heard about in the first talk. Real-time rainfall information from the Met Office, so coming from there, and the others coming from the Environment Agency and from local water companies. We have temperature data, turbidity data. Also, one of the things which we found that the water companies wanted, and the Environment Agency, they have a lot of not very technically qualified staff. And they don't believe data that just comes from sensors. They want to be able to see it. So we have in real time, we have webcams, and you can look at the webcams at the same time, because a lot of their staff won't believe it's flooding unless they can see it. And so you need to be able to look, and it came from here. We also have models at particular places. You can see on the right bottom right-hand side, those of you close, you can see this is real-time river level data from three different sources and different companies from the Environment Agency, from another government project on this, and from water companies. We have different weather data from the Met Office, weather data coming from water companies, weather data coming, precipitation data coming from the Environment Agency, webcams which come from local authorities, and we also have flood modelling. And this is one particular flood model. We have a whole set of different flood models that you can use, and here are the data for the rainfall and the runoff. And without going in any detail at all on this, one of the first things we learned when we talked to farmers, and we had a button right at the beginning which said, "Are you an expert or a beginner?" And all the farmers thought they were experts and we were beginners. And so you need to make all your data available to everybody and then have ways of putting in lots of help me choose buttons and help buttons and so on to get people to what they want. Because what a farmer will want, he will have a less technical knowledge than a scientist, and will have different technical knowledge from a computer scientist. And so you need to be able to refer to things in different ways on these. But everybody reacted badly if they thought they were, by the structure and the questions they were being asked, that things were being kept from them. So we have this, then we have all sorts of descriptions of the models, and we now have talking heads as well. And here is some flood model output, and you can have a different, we pre-potted some examples of what happens if you're rapacious and put as many cows on as you can, or what happens if you forest it, or what happens, things of that sort, as well as being able to put in your own parameters for this. And you can zoom in, look at the results, play with the model, change the parameters, and so on. We've also, and I'm not going to go in more detail, we can talk about that in discussion, because it seems this is an introduction to the discussion rather than anything else. We've had this very regular engagement, and which will continue with all these different groups. We recognized very early on a lot of the people providing data are worried about legal and security issues. So we've had workshops with barristers in London on legal issues, which include things like privacy. What happens if you put public information together and mash it up and you find private information? Who's liable? And that's a real worry for many of the data providers, particularly the commercial data providers like water companies. So it's dealable with, but it's dealable with if you deal with it at the beginning and not once you've got going. Similarly with security issues, and we've had workshops on this to help guide what we do in the future. Also, one of the things that we found very quickly is that you've got people with different levels of mathematical and computing skills, and many environmental scientists don't have very good computing skills. And so we've run summer schools. We now need to look at how we put that online for this. We've done them in Venice, by the way, if anybody's interested in coming in the future. Next, and we're going to turn the pilot at the next stage into an operational prototype. And all sorts of questions about what's the best sort of scalable architecture. We've just had to make some choices. We're not sure we got it right. Automated generation of help and semantics, engagement of multiple data centers and so on. So how to set standards for exchanges and model wrappers, all of that sort of thing. So that's going to be UK-based. For this, we are just going through the process of getting more funding at the moment for this. Beyond that, we've convinced NSF, CSIRO and about 15 other funders internationally in many countries, including India, South Africa, Japan, China, France, and so on, to have an international call, which will happen next spring, through something called the Belmont Forum for issues on standards, governance, and so on. And I hope that's one of the, there are going to be a couple of workshops in the US, there are going to be a couple of town hall meetings, one at the Geological Society of America next month, and one in the beginning of December at the American Geophysical Union. And there are other countries are also going to have questions, comment sessions about, or email online comments, whatever, blogs, to consult the communities in their countries about what should be in this call. But it'll be one call, we hope, across all these countries for doing these different areas. And I hope we might be able to get a jump on all of this. Some of us had a pre-meeting in Reading earlier this year to think what might be in this call, that we might do this so we can feed into NSF and others on this. It's by something called the Belmont Forum, which some of you may be familiar with. But again, we can take it up in discussions. And also, we're working very hard to get further prototypes beyond just what we've done already in the water sector, looking at different sectors such as insurance and climate and so on. And also, one of the drivers is that many of the participants and providers of data have reputational issues and showing that they're open, which is driving what we're doing, which is the opposite of what it used to be, if people want to keep data to themselves out of this. And so these are some of the issues about you're making sure that we have up-to-date issues to integrate the science well and so on. This is PUF. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Robert.
Okay, move on.
Phil, okay.
What's the status on funding continuation of this?
There are three parts, three sorts of funding, like Gaul. The first one is that we have a proposal in that NERC is considering at the moment. It looks quite promising, but they have formally to consider it, and we'll know next spring on the funding for the next phase for continuation of this. There'll also be the Belmont call, which is this international call, which there's money, many agencies are just signing up at the moment, and again there'll be a call next spring from that, and so it'll depend on some of you coming, putting in input to NSF or to NERC or whatever to put money in, but in principle they've agreed this. And by having 13 funding agencies coming together with a few million each, you start to get a fairly significant sum of money. And that'll be more on the infrastructural issues, which might be of more interest in this room than some of the individual science issues. And then I think I'm very confident that within about a month we will have we'll have money for more pilots as well. The ceiling might fall on my head, but I'm pretty confident that this is going to continue.
All right. Thanks very much. Thanks for the invitation to come here and to speak with you. I'll be giving a few case studies today about how interoperability challenges have been handled in some projects that I work with. I'm an oceanographer by training, so this is in some ways much more in my world and my background than this is. But I've been working with projects developing cyber infrastructure for oceanography and related science disciplines for 10 or 15 years now. And so I thought I'd bring you some perspectives from the projects I'm currently working on. I'll look at two main projects, the Ocean Observatories Initiative and Rolling Deck to Repository. And as I talk about these, I'm going to use the same interoperability framework that ILIA has already introduced, so I won't talk through that again, except to say that I'm going to be using these terms, vocabularies, metadata, data access, and data models, as a shorthand for those sort of four concepts of interoperability that ILIA has defined, recognizing that, for example, there is much more to semantic interoperability than just vocabularies alone. This is just a shortcut. So starting first with the Ocean Observatories Initiative, we just heard from Rob some perspectives on how terrestrial observing data can be used to answer some important societal questions. Well, the Ocean Observatories Initiative, or OOI, is developing long-term in-situ instrumentation at several locations in the ocean. And the goal is to start to develop those time series that can produce the same kinds of, if you want, ocean climate models as they have terrestrially. So we can start to think about how ocean climate will change, how biological resources in the ocean, how their availability might change in the future, what some of the processes are on time frames that we've never looked at. So as I said, it's putting long-term instrumentation in the ocean. There's quite a variety of different kinds of instruments. Some of them will have satellite links, some of them are cabled, some of them require a visit to download data. We have fixed assets, we've got mobile assets, so there's quite a variety. And the cyber infrastructure component, which is what I work with, is developing a system that will do two things. First, it is the data access system. It's where scientists, the public, and educators will be able to go to access OOI data. But secondarily, it's also the system through which the instrument operators will manage the instruments. So many of these instruments can be tasked in real time, so we need to have an interface through which they can be, their status can be assessed, sampling can be turned on, can be turned off, the rate of sampling can be changed, mobile assets can be moved, etc. So one of the biggest challenges is OOI is working with about 50 different types of instruments. This is pictures of just a few of them here, and this is difficult because the instrument operator sitting on shore is not going to want to have to remember the specific commands that are used for each individual instrument. Is it power up? Is it start? Is it turn on? Which port do you need to talk to? And similarly, from the data access side, we want to get all the data into a common data model so the user doesn't have to remember that, you know, this CTD is producing hexadecimal and that the third field over is a timestamp, those kinds of things. So the approach that OOI is taking is to write individual, I don't want to get into the details too much, but we've got a package of agents and drivers that work together to translate from the generic OOI cyber infrastructure into the specific semantic and the syntactic level for each individual instrument. And similarly, we have data processing algorithms that define the very specific data format coming off of each and every one of these instruments and how to translate that into the common data model. So evaluating the effectiveness of this approach, well, it's going to work. We have yet to get the first instruments really going in the water, but we think it will serve to meet the needs. However, as far as scalability goes, now if you add a new instrument, assuming it's not quite similar to one we already have, then you're going to need new effort to write the driver agent packages and to handle the data. And other than OOI getting the data into its own internal data model, it's not really moving the field forward with respect to larger interoperability, cross-domain interoperability. A better approach, perhaps, is one that's been proposed by Janet Fredericks at Woods Hole. She started work on this. She's right now trying to get funding to move it forward, is to work with the instrument manufacturers to have self-reporting instruments. So there's a standard through which the instruments themselves will report their settings, their framework, the different aspects of provenance that you need. This would be built off of the Open Geospatial Consortium SensorML, and we're quite hoping that this work is funded and goes forward. Okay, moving now to another project called Rolling Deck to Repository. This is an NSF project led by Suzanne Carbot at Lamont Doherty Earth Observatory. And the goal of this project is to work with the data that are being collected by the fleet of academic research vessels. There's between 25 and 30 active vessels, and all of them have a set of onboard instrumentation that they run continually to the degree possible while they're out on missions. So regardless of the specific science of that expedition, whether it's a biology cruise to a hydrothermal event system or some geologist looking at seamounts, there's this suite of instruments that are running. It includes meteorological stations on board, multi-beam systems to map the seafloor, acoustics doing sub-seafloor imaging, temperatures, currents, things like that. And the goal of R2R is to create a pipeline through which the data are taken off the vessel. They undergo standardization to some degree. They get standard metadata developed for them. In some cases, there's quality assessment and or quality control applied, some standard products created, and then that gets submitted to the national data centers, and from there it becomes available. So one of the interoperability challenges that R2R has had was that we're collecting information and hanging a lot of information around this concept called cruise or an expedition. That's the sort of chunk in which the data comes off the cruise, but it's not a level that's been served by current metadata standards in the past. So the approach was that R2R, this was led by Bob Arco as part of the R2R team and Anna Milan at NGDC, was to extend ISO 19115, which is an international geospatial data standard, to create a new template for cruise level metadata, a metadata standard. This is just a piece of it. It's XML in the background. I did text to show it. So as far as approaches go, we think it was effective. These data are now more searchable, more discoverable by the scientists using terms and concepts they already know. They know about cruises that have gone out. They know about regions they're interested in. They know about vessels they want to look at. Those concepts are in the cruise level metadata. It is scalable. After the initial time investment to create the metadata standard, we now have the processes to kick them out for new cruises. And indeed, other groups are looking at adopting this standard. And it is interoperable because it's a published standard building off of a generic, well-known generic standard that we can, you know, we're talking with our EU partners on either adoption or crosswalking with their ocean vessel information. We also have a data format problem. These operators are capturing the data in whatever idiosyncratic local format they want to. I think out of something like 27 or 28 vessels for which we have GPS data, there are either 21 or 22 distinct formats in which they're being provided, even though in many cases there are only a few different instrument models actually taking the data. So our solution so far has been to build individual parsers, and I forgot to mention it, but also create file format descriptions that can get submitted to help others down the road. So individually for each and every different variant of a data type. Is that effective? Okay, it's getting the job done. Is it scalable? No, every time we get a new format, we've got to go through. And in some cases, they're just small variants on existing formats, but there's, you know, we need to look at each one. Is it fostering interoperability? Well, the R2R work itself in creating those file format descriptions, and in some cases standardizing the formats, is allowing these data to be more interoperable, more widely used, but the approach itself isn't really moving the domain towards interoperability. A better solution would, of course, be adoption of community standards for how to format some of these common data types. But in several cases, these formats already exist. Well-described, for example, NMEA strings are out there, and they're not being used by the operators. And in most cases, it's not because there's a problem with the standard format. It would meet their needs. It's just because they've gotten set up doing it their own way, and there is a cost to changing to the new format. And with very limited resources and limited time, it's a cost they don't want to bear. So this has come up a couple of times already, but in many cases, technology is not the solution or not the only solution. We also need to look at some of the cultural, some of the economic impacts involved. A third challenge is that global research vessels move globally. And so we really need to have global accessibility. Somebody interested in a particular region in the ocean, that region may have been visited by vessels of just about any country. So we are working towards, not just within R2R and the National Ocean Data Centers, but externally with partners. There's an emerging project called the Ocean Data Interoperability Platform. That's a combined EU, US, Australia group. That'll be a platform from which decisions will be made about formats, standards, interoperability, prototypes will be developed. As ODIP gets moving, R2R is working on external interoperability, primarily right now on the vocabulary side. You have these similar concepts, countries, vessels, instrument types, data sets, that appear in a lot of different oceanographic data systems. So the R2R approach is first, and this isn't rocket science, to adopt existing controlled vocabularies where they are available. This is a list of some of them. And secondly, we're implementing a linked data approach to making our contents better described and more interoperable. I think in the interest of time, I won't talk through the acronyms there. Is it effective? It's a little bit too soon to really tell. We think linked data is the way to go. We'll see if it gets used, if that's a useful approach in the end. It is scalable. It leverages from the work that others are doing to describe vocabularies, and it is increasing interoperability by fostering these links and the reuse of descriptions. So to finish, I think I'll just leave with a thinking question. To what degree should we mandate global standards versus allowing for local domain-specific protocols? One approach I've seen in the projects I've worked with is to use a widely adopted standard as a framework, but then within that to allow local extension. So for example, the R2R cruise metadata was built off of and is compliant with ISO 19115. Similarly, if we get these self-reporting instruments going, that would be built off of the OGC sensor ML. So is this an extensible approach? Is this the way to go? Are there better approaches? Are there alternate approaches? Maybe that's something that we can talk about at the description later on. Thank you.
Thanks,
very much.
Thanks, Karen. So we're going to switch to the last panelist, but at the same time, yeah.
All right.
Feel free.
Thanks for a great talk. It's really good to see, you know, the real world application of this. So when we look at metadata across all disciplines, this hierarchy seems common, that you have a discipline hierarchy. So there's an archaeoinformatics session where an archaeologist would say, I have a site that I've been excavating for 40 years, and I'm going there to do a dig this summer, and I have a trench, and I have artifacts in a trench. If I go to, when I used to do wind tunnel testing, it would take, you'd do a two-year program to put a wind tunnel, you'd have tunnel entries. So I go into a tunnel for 1 week, analyze results, go into a tunnel another week, analyze results. So you have this hierarchy that comes up over and over again in X-ray crystallography, on some of the synchrotrons, etc. So I'm thinking in terms of, you know, you talk about a standard for, you know, oceanography, but actually going across global repositories for research, particularly when you're going multidisciplinary, you know, and when I was at Southampton, we ran a project to try and do metadata standards for the whole university for all disciplines, and we had a three-level metadata schema where at the base level it's Library of Congress metadata, right? Author, date, simple stuff. And then drilling down. I mean, what are your feelings in terms of generalizing this out? Because I would argue that every discipline uses exactly this hierarchy of metadata.
It should already be on? Okay. Well, I don't know if you really want to take my opinion on technological things, because I can't even turn a microphone on. So with that caveat, no, I think you're right. And I think on top of even specific things, I mean, I'm calling OGC Sensor ML a generic standard, but it's already quite specific. So I think you need even the level above that of the Dublin core kind of very cross-cutting, the very general concepts that really are shared
by a lot of groups. And I think, you know, a lot of data has geospatial referencing, it has temporal referencing. Those are some of the other concepts that I think, you know, across all domains, we need to have agreements about how to represent and share those, and that'll start us down the path. But interested if there are other perspectives as well.
Yeah. So yeah, we'll carry on the discussion and after Phil's talk.
Thanks. So can people hear me at the back? All right, that's good. Anybody still listening at the back, or have we pummeled you into a stupor at this point? I'll try. I'm going to talk about a slightly different aspect of this that gets back to Drew's opening system. I'm from the University of Redlands, which you probably don't know where it is, but if you go to LA and then get an I-10 and just go due east, if you hit the big wind farms, you missed us. We were that place. What you might notice, Esri, as you went through, because we shared a space with ESRI, and we do a lot of work with those. Our main interest is spatial decision support, and I want to talk a little bit about this. If you want, you can go very deep on this, because with a consortium called the STS Ontology Consortium, we've created a spatial decision support ontology to try to pull together all the various ways that people describe and talk about spatial decision support. And it's a full ontology. It has a web interface that we call the Spatial Decision Support Knowledge Portal. I could go deep on this. There's lots about this. There's a lot of people contributing to this, and we're hoping that this will be part of the way that we try and address some of the core problems that we're facing, and it may be of use to other people. In that, if you drill into that SDS ontology, it talks about one of the things we look at is we look at different workflows that people use in landscape planning and urban planning. There's a number of different workflows in there. There are like NEPA processes. That ontology tries to pull together workflows, methods, tools, everything from coffee clutches to hydrology tools, et cetera, and we try to connect them all together and see which can be used. One particular tool that Carl Steiners out of Harvard has pushed for many years in terms of large collaborative landscape development is a process that has all the usual things you'd expect to see in a process. So I'm not going to go too much details, but you've got a representation model, a process model, how does the thing work, evaluation models, is it working well as far as we're concerned. In the world I'm doing, we like to run with the illusion that we are making changes to the environment that will actually be of some use to somebody, or the environment, or both. So change models is critical, and when you have a change model, then you want to know, if I try and do that, how would it change, as Drew was talking about, if I actually go ahead and make that change that we're thinking about, whether that's to build a new park or to try and restart the Everglades, what are the impacts of the changes we're going to try and make, and at the end of the day, do we want to go forward with those or not, so you have decision models. The main thing to think about this is, you know, very common garden stuff, but one thing that comes in there is that the two levels that you need to know is that when you look at process models, you need an evaluation model. If you look at a forest and look at what the processes that are at work in the forest, what's happening in the forest, the science itself won't give you all the answers. In order to do an evaluation, you have to say, how do we think it's working for us? And then us is whatever us is. So you may have a certain type of beetle, the changes that are happening in the forest at the moment is just great. You're expanding across the United States. If you're people who like to see certain aspects of a forest remain, I did a lot of work at the Giant Sequoia National Monument. If you've ever looked at the Giant Sequoia there, you've seen the last stand of the Sequoia. They're as far up the mountain as they can go and still survive. There's a very thin ridge of them. There's about a couple of hundred groves left at this point. They're a fire-loving species, but the fires that they're facing are now large enough to actually eradicate them permanently. Is that a natural process that should you just let happen, or do you actually try and preserve it? So a lot of agencies and land management agencies, these are the type of questions I deal with all the time. The landscape that we deal with to some extent, we might be able to change what's happening on it. To some extent, the changes are overtaking us. But at both the evaluation model level and at the final decision model level, do we try and do this thing that we're suggesting to do to landscape? There is governance involved in this. And just so when I'm talking about governance, I'm talking about the world in which the ways in which we try and make decisions as a society. So taking Carl's and switching around more into Venn diagram, there's sort of an area of governance, there's an area of the socio-ecology, wherever the system is. If you want to just look at ecology, great. But in most places, when you're working with terrestrial existing communities and so forth, it's not just ecology, it's the socio-ecology, it's the socio-economics, the people that live there, the way that they survive, the way that they make a livelihood, how they relate to that place that they live in, and all of the processes that are happening around them. And then the third part, again, is change. And of course, as Drew was pointing out, if you're following Drew, a lot of the changes that are happening to these systems that we look at are not actually intentional changes in the sense that I'm going to go out and I want to design something and watch what happens. Even as you're designing to change that very system, other things like climate change are busily changing for you, and urban expansion and various other things are happening. So where the boundaries of the system that you want to study and look at its process and so forth are, that obviously depends on how you set up the particular problem you're looking at. And those things are external, or treat these change vectors as external to that, and how the choices you're making and the governance are external. I want to just spend a little time on this because when you look at how does the landscape work, this is where a lot of the science and the sort of science, certainly in the EarthCube science, sort of lives in here. What are the processes that are happening right there? How do they work and how do they work together? If you understand that, you at least have the basics of understanding how a forest works, how vegetation in a forest works, how hydrology and supports that vegetation, how precipitation impacts on that. These are the sort of stuff you might see a lot of. And again, for those that, for planning where you think, we're going to do things and we're going to see what's going to happen, how am I going to change the landscape? If you're dealing with a forest that's so far out, that's so far away from a fire resilient state, but is in a state where a catastrophic fire is not just possible, it's likely in the next 50 years. And by catastrophic, I mean fires that will change that ecosystem in a way that may never be, in a way that's basically, it will go into a totally different state by the time it's finished. Your coniferous forest may well be replaced by oak and savanna, which is really beautiful, but it's a very different ecosystem. And with the climate change slowly drying out precipitation, it may become a permanent ecosystem. So you're seeing biome shifts now that are starting to happen. And your question is, do you try and interfere with that? Do you try and change that? Again, you could argue that this is gardening on a mega scale. But again, if you like those groves, and if those groves are now disappearing, those beautiful sequoia groves, do you fight to save them, or do you basically say whatever processes are happening, they are what they are, just let it go? There are big questions on governance that you really have to decide who's going to make those decisions, what's the parameters in those decisions, and it's not just a question for us in terms of this, of just looking at the science of the thing. We have to put all of these factors together. When you look at governance, it's a question of how do you evaluate the landscape. As I said, when you look at something like the Giant Sequoia National Monument, which is one of those monuments that you get created every now and then, they pop up, made by Bill Clinton pretty much as he resigned. It's a small enough monument, but it's critical because it has a lot of the groves. It is, after 50 years of firefighting, it is incredibly, got way too much fuel sitting on it that now the type of fires that can run through it are enough to actually burn out the entire groves. And the Forest Service does amazing things to stop that happening, but is that sustainable? How are we going to change that? So from one perspective, you might say, there's a group of people who strongly believe that the Forest Service should get out of there and let whatever happen. That's what nature's about, and the more that the agencies try and actually get involved in stuff and make choices, the more they screw things up. There are other people who believe that, and it was the agencies that made the imbalance in the first place, and they should be correcting it. They should let more fires happen there, et cetera. A lot of the science occurs then is that if I have an idea about the type of changes I can do, maybe I'll start allowing a lot more wildfires. I'll take risks. I'll allow a wildfire to burn a lot more on the forest, which is pretty tough on those people who actually live in the forest. They may just have to get with the idea they might lose their houses. But if I can get enough wildfire to run in the forest, I might get it back to a fire resilient stage again, the way it was maybe 200 years ago. But what was 200 years ago? Early settlers have accounts that when they first moved into that area, I'm going to say early settlers, early European settlers, when they first moved into that area, every summer they almost choked because the Native Americans at the time were always burning the forest to keep it open and to keep areas for wildlife. So in fact, every summer apparently that area was totally full of smoke because of these intentional fires that were set that were actually managing that area for hundreds and hundreds of years prior to that. So again, what is the state of the ecology? Is it the natural state? Is it out of a natural state? What is the new natural state? But the science has a lot to do that. If I do my modeling over here is well done, and the way that I envisage change is well done, I should be able to relate the actions I'll take over here to actual impacts on the processes that are happening here, which I can then run through and say, if I've developed metrics to evaluate how well this system, whether ecosystem, socio-ecology is working, and I think it's not working well, then in theory, if I take actions over here, they'll have impacts on the processes here. When I rerun the metrics here, when I forecast ahead, I'll hopefully see that those metrics are moving in a direction that we and that our governance people say, oh, that's better. We're moving the socio-ecology in the direction that we want. Of course, there's a whole other aspect here, too, is that when you take these actions, the governance comes into place here, too. Maybe I can't afford those. One of the problems with a lot of forests, though, when you look at the forest fuel treatments that are being suggested over the next 10 or 15 years, people are looking at maybe treating 5% of the forest. Okay, you do that this year, 5%. Next year, you do 5%. More along 10 years, the first 5% you've done has actually pretty much been overgrown again and disappeared, and you haven't even got to the other 80%. You may be looking at situations where actually any actions that are being taken at the moment, even though they're using a lot of money, are actually having no impact on the situation. So what is society willing to pay for actions that would actually change the situation in the direction that they've decided they wanted to go? So this is the world that we work in. It's e-science is critical to it, but it's not the whole picture, unless maybe e-science has got a larger definition. Looking at what Drew was talking about this morning, if that's everyone's idea of e-science, then these next few slides are going to be a bit odd. So we can't work this spatial decision board can't work without all the sort of core e-science that particularly EarthCube is focused on. It has a lot in common with it. We're very focused on decisions about intentional actions, but of course we have to accommodate those external changes that are happening to the ecosystem. Our change models of representation must be integral with socio-ecology system models. In other words, when I say this is how I'm going to change it, if I can't relate that back to the processes I modeled in the first place and how those processes will be impacted, I can't tell you anything about what the future forecast is. And of course, as people keep mentioning, both need to be validated and uncertain and uncertainly estimated. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a sec. And computation, of course, is key. If you can't run these models, you can't do much with them. Where we feel that, this is coming a little bit out of our efforts to push the EarthCube a little bit, where we feel there's some great differences is that in our world, most of the time, the governance models are explicit. We try and actually understand from the get-go how will the decisions be made, what type of criteria will be taken into account, what is the state that you're trying to believe you want to get this into, you want to move this system into. Those may be realized goals for people have. They have, you'll notice that there are a lot of notices of intent from the various agencies will try and say, we think that the ecosystem should look like this, but it's not, and we need to figure out how to get it there. That's a pretty amazing start. If that's the case, we try to make sure that type of thinking is modeled explicitly in what we do so that we can actually figure out, okay, if that's the case, will these actions get you there or not? One big thing to think in the world I'm in, a lot of times type 2 errors may be a lot less acceptable than type 1 errors. In other words, as a scientist, you don't want to say something that's wrong. If you're dealing with some of the ecosystems that we're dealing with, I'm running a large project with Fish and Wildlife on the desert tortoise, which covers about 4 states. The problem with the desert, one of the key things that's happening with the desert tortoise, it's a long-lived critter. It can live up to 60 years. So any changes you make now in terms of recovery actions, you may not see that for 40, 50 years. Meanwhile, across the huge range of this this critter that's been around for about 6 million years, it is declining everywhere. There is no place you can look and say, oh, things are okay here. If we could just make the rest of the range work like this, we'll be fine. In every single place we look at, it's declining. We don't actually know why. I'll come back to that in a little bit. So if you're the Desert Tortoise Recovery Office, which is part of Fish and Wildlife, and you're set up with a mandate because this is the Endangered Species Act and all of its peculiar wisdom is focused on this one animal specifically, and your job is to try and see if you can actually effect this recovery of the species, can you afford not to take actions now? Can you, if you try and actually monitor and do experiments, it may take 40, 50 years before you actually have any impact. By that time, the tortoise may have been, moved beyond a point where we just simply can't recover it in any of its natural range. So that's, I think that's a sort of a compelling aspect of this, is that this question of that maybe you need to act even though you don't know quite what's best, but what can you do in the interim to try and maximize the probability that you're heading in the right direction? Spatial decision force is even more, the driver for a lot of interoperability is the idea of cross-disciplinarity, that you're going to try and pull information from different scientific areas together. Well, you can pretty much guarantee that in any major spatial decision support problem, that's built into it. You'll want to pull in legal and socioeconomic. You'll want to put in many different types of information from totally different fields in which no one uses the same language. That's part of why we started the SDS ontology, was because when we try to have conversations with people from urban planning and other places, we discover we use words that are spelled the same, but they sure didn't mean the same across the different disciplines. But they were close enough to be beautifully confusing. It can be, this spatial decision board can be more directly experimental. It's about taking actions. If I take this action, what will happen? It's a lot harder to do an experiment on global climate warming, unless we can get some big replicators going. So people are always like, oh, this is great. But we have adaptive management. We can try and change the forest this way in this area, and then try a different place in a different part of the forest, see which ones work better, and then go ahead and use it. But again, the problem is sometimes the experiments will take even longer timescales than the lifetime of the ecosystem you're trying to preserve, or the particular system you're trying to preserve. And again, decision efforts are often episodic. As you all know, we're inclined to make a decision as a once-off thing. Hey, we made this thing. We took a couple of actions. Well done. Let's disband the committees. Let's disband the public oversight groups. And we'll come back in 10 years' time, and maybe something will have happened that was positive, or maybe not. And usually by the time you get back to us 10 years later, everyone was involved 10 years ago. In the last time you tried to make a plan for this particular area, they've all either left or moved on or changed jobs. And people can't even find the Word documents that were left from that last effort. I want to try and wrap up because you guys have been so patient. So I'm going to try and cut this faster than I was thinking. But I want to just point out a couple of things, like non-native invasive species management. One of the core things. It was great to see Drew's systematic approach to uncertainty estimation and so forth. Because when we're doing it, it's a lot of ad hoc stuff going on, and yet we're sort of flying the flag of yes, we want uncertainty here. If you're a person whose job is to figure out on a base, when I look at all the various infestations of plants that used to be here and have all sorts of impacts on my resources, both threatened and endangered species, on my training facilities, on my buildings, on my roads. And you want to look at what type of jobs, what type of work, how do we want to spend my finite budget? Where do we want to try and which of these weed patches do I want to fight and why? We've built systems for that. I just want to point something to the bottom, is that when we're talking about uncertainty to a manager, because that's one of the key differences, is that in our world, again, we have a manager at the end of the day who will make a decision and want to be able to explain to his superiors and his funders why I'm making this decision. So when we look at uncertainty, we try and look at uncertainty in ways that are relevant to the decision maker. So in this case, for instance, if you have a system with a nice dashboard and it looks good, and it says, hey, here are the top 20 patches of all the 200 or 300 are there that look like they're having they would threaten your base in the largest possible way and across all of the various aspects that you care about, nice multi-criteria decision models, consensus, convergence, elicitation, all sorts of clever stuff. At the end of the day, he doesn't care anybody. He's like, okay, so you're telling me I should spend my money on these guys. I want to know if all of those expert weights and all those parameters are shifted. I want to know whether or not the top 50 or so that I think I can afford patches I'm going to treat this year, will they stay stable, or are you going to tell me that under a reasonable set of Monte Carlo experiments that you can't tell me which 50 I should spend my money on because they just change so much? Turns out that we got lucky in this case, that in fact there's actually quite a lot of stability. Those that are in the top 50 stayed in the top 50 over quite a range of experiments that we tried. We don't have Drew's parameter estimation approach. We look at variance in our expert opinion. We look at variance in the numbers and input data. So it's not as rigorous, but it gives us a sense of where we're trying to go with this and try to give something back to the managers. With the desert tortoise, I'm going to flip through here. It's a huge range. We've actually spent about 3 years It's a very contentious situation because if you find a desert tortoise in your backyard, there's a whole bunch of things you can't do with your backyard at that point, and you know, expand the backyard to large areas of four states, and you have a lot of contention. And so one of the things we've had to do is that, two things. One is that there is no single thing that's killing off the desert tortoise. All these red things are different threats that are in the literature. In different parts of desert tortoise range, some of these are more dominant than others. So you can't just toss them out and say, hey, we can just whittle this down to four or five things we need to worry about. We have to keep them all in play. Most of the time, in a lot of the projects we're working on, we don't have that wonderful thing that everyone starts off the talks here with, which is we have huge amounts of data. What do we do with it? We spend most of our time doing what we have really, really, really little data. A lot of these links, every one of these links in the model, you can click on it. This is online, by the way. This model is publicly available because we had to get people to go through and validate it, and we've done that. Every link has got a citation where it came from, what goes on. But some of these might be like, you know, three tortoises were crushed once. In 20 years, we found three tortoises crushed by off-road vehicles. Therefore, there's a link between off-road vehicles and crushing. So we have very little data. It's very hard to get data. To give you a horrible, sad thought about this, that despite the millions and millions we spent on this, we don't even have a good density distribution of desert tortoises in their range. And talking about social stuff, the best data on that is sitting in a filing cabinet in an agency I will not name, where we're waiting for someone to retire so that data will be released and we can actually use it and finish off a large amount of work. We had to do a tremendous amount of expert elicitation on what is the relative contribution of one threat to particular stresses in the model. Here's a variance you see. There's a lot of it. That's great. We've used this variance in those weights across sets of experts. But one thing is that I didn't. One thing I should mention about this: if you were to spend time looking at these threats, they vary tremendously. You're looking at things like military bases and their impacts on landfills. So this has nothing to do with ecology. So asking ecologists about what they think the relative contribution of development of urbanization and military bases are on landfill development is probably not the best group of people to ask. So there are many, many different fields in here that are all contributing to this. At the end of the day. We are trying to provide what we started this project to do is that when you look at recovery actions, you think about actually spending money on recovery actions on the tortoise, we'd like to try and use the best science we can get and pull together and say, okay, we think that this recovery action is likely to be more effective now, so please, if you're going to spend money, spend it on that particular type of recovery action. So a lot of uncertainty in here. Let's call this 2.5. It turns out, as you probably know, that there is a tremendous tremendous interest right now in bringing alternative energy into the Mojave Desert. It's a wonderful place for sun. And so if you look at all of the proposed projects of any sort that are either being formally put in or in the pipeline, you're looking at about 20% of the Mojave Desert being under mirrors. Mojave Desert is a huge desert. I mean, you're talking about changes. In the old days, a solar plant might have been 200 acres. Now it's 15,000 acres. So you're looking at huge changes to this desert. And so it turns out that our system, we can look at if you suggest a solar project, we can put it down on the map. We can run our model and see which stresses will be increased by plunking that down there. We can look at offsetting recovery actions, which is how normally you deal with the resource problem like that, and we can say those recovery actions, little blue bars, they will reduce stress in the following way. Our model does not have an official governance model. We hand this back to the agency and say, so you figure out if you're happy with that or not. It's not, we are staying away from that. As Drew was pointing out, that leads to all sorts of interesting questions which are, you know, currently bubbling up, all sorts of good legal questions. If the agency uses our model and it turns out our model is wrong, in whatever way you want to prove the model is wrong in the future, they'll get sued. If the agency decides not to use our model because it's still under development, we're only on phase four, and doesn't use our model, then they're going to get sued because they didn't use, if our model is considered to be the best model out there, then they'll get sued because they didn't use our model. So there's tremendously tricky questions around this that bring the science and the governance together. I'm going to skip over lots of fun stuff that I could have dragged you through, but I think you've seen enough. But I do want to point out what we're trying to do on in our world is that there is a thing called EMDS, which is the Ecological Management Decision Support System, which was developed by the Forest Service many years ago. It has a community out there to use it for all sorts of things. It even has its own little Wikipedia, citation, which is always good to tell you. It must be real if it's in Wikipedia. There's a bunch of different applications it's been used for. It has a community. And so we're basically taking that and tearing it apart. It used to have a fixed workflow for landscape assessment, we've redone it on Windows workflow. We're busily working, and if there's any people here who are experts on Trident integration, talk to me. We have questions. We're pulling into Trident because we want to bring it into an open architecture. Some of the key things that we do with this is that we have incorporated, and we want to keep doing that. We're trying to make an open system where we can drop in specialized engines. Right now, we have a fuzzy logic engine. We have a multi-criteria decision analysis engine. We just dropped in an inference engine from LPA in England. We're looking at dropping in an optimization engine, and off we go. And we want to make that easy. We want to wrap those engines. We want to make it available. This system is freely available for download, so anyone can use it. It's been, and so we're in the middle of trying to do our bit for interoperability by taking a closed tool that's been quite successful, turning it into a much more open tool, which means A, we can move all of our many projects onto the same infrastructure, but B, we can do all the things that we were talking about earlier, have provenance, be able to share it, have other people rerun it, so that we can actually get this down. So I'm just skipping through all of these. One of the things that might be of interest, one of the things we're very interested in is that by developing domain ontology, like for species recovery, there's a guy called Solaski who's got some really good stuff on a lexicon of species recovery, that we can actually populate our models and our tools based straight from the ontology itself. So that instead of having us with idea of threats, stresses, and so forth that we have hard-coded in there, we actually pull them straight out of an ontology where anyone else can share and work on the definitions. And we're also using this ontology to, I won't go into too much detail, but going for the grand challenges of planning workflows, domain workflows, and scientific workflows, we can use some of our SDS ontology to actually help put constraints on some of the aspects, skipping as fast as I can, click. That we are, sorry about this, because our model has lost itself, we can use our higher level ontology to actually apply constraints for scientific workflows, so that if you start designing a workflow, we can help you actually get all the right pieces in there by constraining the space that you're searching in to find all the tools and methods that you want to actually bring into play on this. So we think there's some value in this ontology approach in the whole area. We have a nice big scary diagram that tells us everything will work together someday. We have a couple of things that are working for us. We've made some good progress. We have lots of questions, some of which I already know I can talk to Robert about. One of the things that, just a couple of things to finish with. How far do we go with auto-composed GUIs? This is one of our biggest problems, is that each of our engines is very specific. It has very specific analytic front ends, which is great for analysts, and that's great, but end user decision maker, a manager managing an installation, a forest supervisor managing a forest, they don't care about any of that. They want to have an interface that is meaningful to them, that answers a question, that is defensible when their boss or the local groups says to them, hey, I don't get it, why the hell are we doing that? Which is the classic question. So to have that, we found that we've developed many different interfaces once off that do the job for a particular group, and this is where I think the observatory, definitely want to talk more about that and who's doing observatory stuff in the States, because it sounds like you guys actually went systematically after that. We backed into that. And so one of our questions is, when we build these workflows, how much can we automate the end user? Because we want to do rapid prototyping. We want to build something and six weeks later, show a forest supervisor, yep, we pulled in all the data you've had guys had available. We turned in some modeling that we found out there. We already have a system to start to go places. Where do we go next with it? And so we need that. So there's a couple of questions here. Then the last one, which sort of gets back, is that when we finish this Trident thing, our next step will then be to put it into the interop testbed. So we've got to figure out with Ilya, how the hell do we get it to run in the interop testbed? So that's one of the places we're going to. Thanks very much.
Thanks.
Thanks, Phil. So I'd like to ask panelists to come up here and then sit on these high chairs, expose yourself. I'm surprised that. So the first time I did I think it was in 2009, I did the Trident workshop at eScience. Right. Who else in the audience familiar with what you ever used Trident? Two. Yeah. Right. There was one gentleman over there. Yeah, we should talk. And then I really wanted to, get a heckle out as soon as possible. But anyway, we can carry on with the questions. So I'm going to do my marathon to the audience and whoever wants to. And we can also start with your seed questions, Ilya.
Right. So you've seen that we have very different people in the group. That makes it very interesting. You've been exposed to the whole variety of approaches and
thoughts that we have within just our small group focused on cross-domain interop. Feel free to ask questions. Actually, questions were towards the end of all of our talks. Not sure if you remember them, but take
right.
it away.
And you can see that the five of us really present a different perspective about this interoperability cross domain. As Philip was saying, that we may use the same terms, but we may mean different things. Anyone has?
This question would be for Karen. When you mentioned the metadata modification, compliant to the ISO standard for geographic metadata standard, I wonder how much is your modification or your version of the metadata schema differ from, say, the US standard, the FGDC, the continent standard for digital geospatial, metadata?
Thank you for the question. FGDC doesn't cover the very specific research cruise related fields that are in ICE, or that, excuse me, are in the cruise metadata standard. And so the way we've embedded it in ISO is that there are sort of more generalized concepts under which the idea of a cruise fits. So we slotted it in the appropriate place in the hierarchy, but then we define out new specific fields to cover things like the port of entry and the date of departure, things like that. There have been mappings between FGDC and ISO 19115, so I don't really know how to answer your question more specifically than that. There probably would be a way to similarly slot this set of cruise-related fields into the appropriate place in FGDC, but I haven't specifically looked at that.
What's the percentage of the number of elements in the ISO standard have you adopted? And then, so that's the, I'm just curious.
So when R2R provides its metadata reports, it uses a suite of fields from 19115. I don't know the number of them, but it has tried hard to implement all of those that make sense for this data type. And then as far as the specific number of additional new fields that it's adding, I really don't know that off the top of my head, but we have the cruise metadata standard is accessible online. I'd be happy to get you the link and we can talk, maybe look at it together and talk through it if that would be valuable.
You've all spoken this morning about trying to get interoperability and integration in quite a very narrow science area, such as the environmental sciences here. And, there was a meeting last week in Washington on the Research Data Alliance, which was trying to do what you're, or to start the process of doing what you're doing here, just in the environmental area, across data, scientific data more generally. Do you think that sort of approach... do you think even your approach is possible, never mind an even more global approach to trying to get integrated mechanisms for metadata, data access, data models, and so forth? Or should we just accept that scientific data is really inherently only relevant to those people who are producing it?
Yeah. Environmental science is amazingly broad. I mean, it covers about half. I mean, if you include all the economics and the legal and the social science as well as science itself, you've probably got about half of all the departments in the university have something related to it.
there. So I don't agree with you that it's a narrow field. I think these examples are somewhat narrow because you have to start somewhere. But I think a lot of them, I mean, I know quite a lot of what the area Karen's working in, for instance. There's a lot of overlap in the sort of back office functions of what she's doing and what we're doing, because there are people in my shop who are very related to doing things very related to what Karen's doing on this, for instance. I think you've got to start somewhere. I think there are very different ways in which people in different fields address data, and it isn't just scientists, it's beyond that. I mean, I was thinking this morning, I actually have a question for Drew, which I will pose much more generally, is that if we actually show our uncertainty to non-specialists, how do we, that has economic consequences, how do we actually do that in some way that doesn't that completely stuff the whole field of people wanting to share data with each other? Actually, and so I think there are a lot of areas, and we've certainly learned a lot from the astronomers, for instance, in what they're doing. Different communities have different amount of reflection and how much they want to show that publicly. I mean, the astronomers, for instance, have a lot of ways in which they wish to expose their thinking while papers are being created, whereas some other fields are not wanting to do that because of economic consequences as much as anything else. I think we can do things generally, but we do have to be cognizant. I think the front ends will look different.
If I could just add to that too, I mean, I came out of another misbegotten theoretical physics gone wrong, the software company I have in Seattle that makes multi-criteria decision analysis, for first year we couldn't report on a single use of our software because it was all waste remediation. Emergency type moments where a firm discovers there's something horrible leaking out their backyard, and they use our software, but we couldn't get anyone to write a case study because who wanted to write a case study about their unfortunate disaster in their backyard? And so it's only recently that I've actually ended up in a world of actually hitting environmental science. Most of our biggest customers are Raytheon and large development companies who create stuff. And so I think all of these questions, I mean, I've just found the environment that I think people, there's a lot of focus here, there's a lot of organization, I think is a great starting springboard, but I expect, the reason I'm interested in this is that we will end up in a very broad world way beyond what's called environmental science or environmental concerns. Yeah.
And you want to add to that?
One additional statement. The situation is highly dynamic. Of course, there are standards development bodies that try to come up with standards that would cross that would be used across geosciences and environmental sciences. If we look at several recent standards, say climate science markup language, water markup language, they are based, and several others, they're based on observation and measurements specification by Open Geospatial Consortium, and that at least ensures that we have common representations of time, space, and measurements that we can use to integrate across domains. At the same time, new data types are continuously being developed, which do not yet have standard expressions, and so it's a dynamic process. New data types, new types of measurements appear that need to be captured, and so there is standardization process as well.
So I had a question for the panel, because I think this is something that I think probably you've all thought about a lot, so I'd be interested in hearing your views on the extent to which we're limited by the incentive structure that would make people put the effort into standardizing their data and sharing it. And if so, you know, how can we create an incentive structure that might really take off and work?
Yes, I mean, one of the other things where I didn't talk about is we've been working with the Royal Meteorological Society, who have started a journal now based on our prodding, so that you don't just put a DOI on data, it actually counts as a refereed publication on data sets. So I encourage you all to put things into it as we went through the agony of creating it. other societies are starting to do the same thing. So that's the scientific thing. I think sitting in a university which was besieged by freedom of information requests in the same way UEA was, I think the wish, at least in environmental science, for people, the public, to want to know what is going on and to want to be seen, and people then, as scientists, want to be seen to being ethical and making them their stuff available, and the costs of not making it available, which is immense. My university could get bankrupted by the number of cases that we get requests if we didn't meet all of them because of the level of fines we would get. And that's probably true of every organization in this room, including Microsoft. if it happened. And I mean, this is in the billions in terms of fines. So there's that negative thing, but there's a strong positive wish, I think, for most companies as well as most individuals and most scientists to be seen to be behaving ethically.
I think you get it.
I don't have a lot of insight, but I just wanted to agree with you entirely. I think if you're in an academic world and you decide to take time to develop a new metadata standard, you're shooting yourself in the foot as far as career progress goes. So it tends to be something that, you know, if you're a well-established post-tenure researcher, you can get away with it. Or a lot of the people I work with, they're all self-money researchers. They're all scrambling for grants. They don't have funding yeah. lines from the university. Wondering if I spoke with a foundation this oh, morning yeah, representative yeah. who was also very aware of this problem. It's something they're thinking
yeah,
about.
Which is why I thought it's exciting that when we at the EarthCube, when we talk about education, we're associated with workforce development. I think there is a whole ecosystem that needs to be developed when you talk about new way of publishing, new ways of computing, all that. You have to consider the identity of people.
I forgot one thing in terms of negative incentives. At least in the UK Natural Environment Research Council, which has data centers, you have to put your data in the data center or you can't apply for another grant. That's a pretty good incentive.
Mm-hmm.
One second. There are very different interests and types of rewards and types of recognition that community members would take. So, for example, if you look at Stack Exchange or Stack Overflow, reputation points, plus ones, how many plus ones you get would not really help in the academic world, or reputation points would not be a system for part of the rewards, but it would be a huge rewards for somebody who are at the undergraduate student level. And we also have witnessed the changes in the reward systems that a couple years ago there were no reputation points or badges that people would count on, but it becomes more and more popular. So eventually we may look at quite different system of rewards used in science, and hopefully that will be based on data.
Yeah, I think you get a great panel here with all different backgrounds from the EarthCube, ocean science, and decision support and all the computational sciences. And I think probably this is a good time to throw out a bigger question. In your own research, we see all this wonderful research you have been doing. What do you think is the most challenging interoperability problem? Just one. And how did you solve that? We know a lot existing over there, like metadata, ontology, semantics, workflows, but which one is the biggest?
It's the people side of it, I think. It's changing cultures, it's changing deeply ingrained workplace practices, and we haven't solved it yet. So I can't give you that side of your question, but that's what I see. I think the technology can come, but how do we create the incentive structures to get people there?
Just following on that, the issue of trust, how you can trust data produced elsewhere, what would be sufficient for you to understand whether you can trust data produced by others, that includes provenance, that includes usage information, fitness for use, all of these issues, but also whether you can see who produced the data, whether you can trust that person, how you relay this information, what is the role of social networks, what is the role of social relationships that you can use to support trust. That's very critical.
Well, I just and Tyler too. Again, from where I'm coming from, I think one of the key issues is I think EarthCube does that in principle. They try to connect things to the grand challenges that are out there. Is that most of the science we're doing and we're involved in. There's science for science itself, which is the older model I grew up with, but then there's also science that is almost immediately and has a need. And these days, the amount of need that's out there is humongous. I mean, as in there are so many problems we have to make decisions about now that we don't have the science right there. And I think we need a better system for promulgating the needs through. It doesn't mean everyone has to abandon what they're doing and say, oh, I've got to do a needs-oriented stuff. I think we had Margaret Thatcher in England that did a fine job with theoretical physics on that area, how not to do that. But on the other hand, we need a way that it's easier for the desperate needs that are out there, for decisions that have to be made now, to push and communicate to scientists, hey, we have a great need for this now, anybody interested? And find incentives to get people to actually start producing that. And one thing just last about, there's many other data produced apart from academics. I mean, most of the data, for instance, with the desert tortoise came from agencies, came from counties, came from all sorts, and military, came from all sorts of places. And one thing we found is that when we took the data in, even with our ridiculously simple first model that we ran in iteration one, it's still ridiculously simple, but it's a little more sophisticated than it used to be. When people see their data in a model being used and coming back in a way that first people can say, well, that's really rubbish. And we're like, well, yeah, but, you know, it's the data. Oh, yeah, that's my data. And they're like, I can get you better data than that. And that really started a thing that is moving forward, where it's exciting to see your data used, and I think that's something we might underappreciate.
Yeah, Robert, you want to?
No, I'm just agreeing.
Finally. Oh, okay. Yeah, Tony.
It's been very interesting to hear Drew's keynote and your four different perspectives on environmental science in the broadest sense. What I see is that they're very different in very. I mean, I agree that with Robert that it's a much broader area than, for example, particle physics, which I originally came from. So is it conceivable that there can be some generic level of services, cloud services, for example, or workflows that are generic across these disciplines? It seems to me rather difficult.
Well, we hope so, because we're going to try it. So, I mean, clearly there are issues of scaling and on architectures, on ontologies, on various other areas that are going to make it difficult. But if in many ways, as environmental sciences as a whole is predicated on the fact that there are cross linkages, actually, not just this part of it. So I don't think it's that. I mean, we do services already as a unit, personally, you know, Tony, we started in oceanography and then we got into land processes in climate. There's a need for it. I think it's harder when you get beyond physical sciences in many ways, although there's a lot of interesting developments in biological sciences as well, as we were hearing, for it and getting the cross linkages. But people are doing it.
Ready for the next question? Okay. This is a question that I don't think we'll be able to answer here, but but that's what this session is about, correct?
Yes.
And I really appreciate the comments of all of the... Can you hear me? I really appreciate the comments of all of the panelists, and I wanted to touch on the issue that I think Karen raised in her presentation about to what degree do we mandate global standards versus allowing for the local domain-specific protocols, and all of you have touched on very local issues that were necessary in order to make a start, as Robert says. But I'm wondering if you have thoughts at this time, given your locally based experiences, whether there needs to be some kind of a nested approach in terms of the global, like Dublin Core metadata kinds of standards. The global level is needed, but nesting in the local as well. And if that is a way to assess the quality of the interoperability.
Okay.
That's indeed a question we cannot answer. But we can talk about that for a long time. And indeed, there are different points of view. And as I said, the situation is highly dynamic. Perhaps if the community starts by developing local standards, that will help the community to figure out what is the information models that are fundamental to the types of measurements that they collect. And that these models can be mapped to standards that have been developed starting from, you know, with a top-down approach. If we can connect these bottom-up and top-down approaches in a meaningful way and show enough examples and show enough use cases where it's used and can be applied, then it is going to be a useful standard. Now, then we also can talk about different levels of interoperability. At some level, where we just need to register resources for initial discovery, we don't need that much metadata. That's where Dublin Core or Inspire type standards would be perfect. When we go deeper and want to extract some components of the information model that information models that we use to integrate data, that's where we need compatible definitions of time, space, and measurements, and that's where we need more advanced information models, of course. So it depends on your application area, I would say, or scenarios.
Okay, so question, how much you distinguish the interoperability issue related to data structure and models and to the infrastructure that need to support this data? Because sometimes different science require different infrastructure, but they are actually like explicit, implicit. So you don't think about infrastructure, but if you talk between different domains, actually you need probably compatibility between supporting infrastructure.
Anybody wants to answer? I can try. That's another question that is very difficult to answer. We have to start with some level of abstraction at which we can treat different domains and different infrastructures in somewhat compatible fashion. And one of the starting points in our approach is we look at it at several levels, at the level of catalog integration, vocabulary integration, services integration, and information models. So this is our level of abstraction. At this level sort of hides specific infrastructure implementations. If we go deeper, then we certainly need to see what are our metrics of success for interoperability. And someone asked the question about how we measure quality of interoperability. That is a question about metrics. If we want to be able to federate different types of data or combine different types of data quickly within a certain amount of time, then that implies infrastructure requirements. So I don't have an answer, direct answer to your question, of course, but the way to do that, to approach this, is to look at different use cases that require different types of integration and see whether they're supported by existing.
If the question of infrastructure is about data and how you store your data and how you communicate it, I think in some ways that's an easier problem to solve. And I think like both ESRI and Microsoft are making huge leaps. In fact, some of the push for EarthCube was that the cyber infrastructure efforts at NSF were building wonderful sharing and storage and cloud capabilities, but people weren't using them that much. And in fact, in some ways, the infrastructure that they were investing in was getting ahead of the actual usage. And so I think, maybe it's naive, but I believe we can solve the infrastructure with well-known approaches. I think it's the rest of it, the actual making them work together and like getting people to actually put real systems on it and do real calculations that I think is the harder part we're trying to solve right now.
So I'm an astronomer, and so let me offer just a couple comments. Astronomical community has got its act together fairly well, by and large. But first I have to quote Jim Gray, who paraphrased Haldane, said that God must be inordinately fond of standards. That's why he made so many of them. Now, you cannot impose these by fiat from above. It has to be organic, and scientists will never accept things like that. They always act out of enlightened self-interest. And they're really, the reason why you would do this is, well, it's either because of data reuse, so you can get credit for people using your data, or data fusion, so that you can combine the data sets to discover new stuff, and then everybody has to play by same rules. Now, there are several things to standardize. One is the data formats, and that's where heterogeneity will kill you. Astronomical data are more heterogeneous than, say, high-energy physics, but not nearly as much as environmental science. And so that's where difficulties will really come, coming so many, right? Then you have to standardize metadata, and that tends to be pretty boring. People have to accept that. And finally, you have to standardize the protocols for data access and exchanges. Now, astronomers standardized formats fairly early on, but the other two, metadata and protocols, were pretty much done through virtual observatory framework, and that's probably the best thing virtual observatory has done. So you need to have self-interested professionals who are deeply involved in, say, data centers, data distribution, and they come up with reasonable solutions, and then you simply have market winners. Everybody starts using something because everybody's using it. And that's the only way it will work.
Thank you, George. So that concludes this panel, and thank you all very much for participating. Lunch is ready out there. Thanks again.